I'm here at Outlaws Boxing talking to boxing trainer Brandon Krause. And if you want to do feints like Mayweather, like Pacquiao, like Canelo, watch this video. It's going to help you improve on your feint game.
Feinting is what, you know, makes boxing a beautiful thing, is that in other sports, you're so reliant on the physical realm that, you know, the bigger, faster athlete in baseball, basketball, football, because of the parameters of those games, are going to have a huge advantage. But here in the boxing ring, we can use our minds to negate somebody's natural advantages, either in height, speed, size, strength. One of the great ways we can do it is by feinting, all right? Uh-huh. Now, feinting is in boxing lingo what we call faking.
You just think in basketball, where you fake someone out of, you know, you fake him, yeah. You shake him.
Anything that you can do in the ring, you can pretend to do, right? But you want to have an overall purpose for it. You know, you don't want to just feint and get your opponent to commit to something and not do anything about it. You're trying to expose them and then make them pay for that, right? So, like, let's say...
We have David over here.
David, is defending against my jab with the parry, right? And one of these times I could feint it and come around the side with the hook. Or maybe he's doing the same thing with my jab, right? And then I show him that and try to capitalize with another punch, all right? I have a way that I'm helping all the outlaws here today experiment with the feinting. Mm-hmm. And what I'm doing is for one round, one of them will be on the jab the whole time. So let's say for the rest of this round, David's on the jab, and he's trying to hit me with it, and I'm trying to defend. And when David thinks like I'm going to fall for it, he's going to try to feint me and expose me and try to get me to fall for it. Not only expose me, but select the correct punch that will go along with how I'm exposing myself. Now, I don't care how proficient of a boxer you are, somehow, some way, you foreshadow what you're going to do before it happens. Whether or not an opponent can pick it up, that's another story, all right? And every fighter's foreshadowing is going to be a little bit different. So as David's throwing that jab at me, he's also studying how I like to defend against it and what I end up doing. And now, feinted jab and come hook. And now if he kept me coming out, he saw that I kept going to that parry maneuver again and again and again, and he made me pay for it by feinting the jab and exposing me for the hook. Now, I can make it more difficult for David, right? Because I know, hey, this guy wants to feint me. So I don't want to just keep parrying. I want to start mixing it up, adding slips, blocking, using my feet. And then the more different methodology that I can show him as far as my defense goes, the more difficult it's going to be for him to ultimately feint me.
Okay.
But anyways, this drill is going like this. The whole round, he's on the jab. And I'm defending against it. When he thinks I'm going to fall for it, he comes with a feint shot, all right? And then the following round, I'll throw the jab. We'll go through the lead right hand, and we'll go through the lead left hook the same way. Like, for instance, David, defending against my left hook. Defend against my left hook. Ha! Oh, sucker for the body shot. But I'm allowing these outlaws to see what can work and what won't work. One of the big things I'm telling them is this. If I was going to approach throwing this hook at David like this, and then very timid, he doesn't really have to do any mental focus energy to defend against it. So when I try to feint this one and come with a different shot, well, he never put himself out of position because my original shot wasn't anything that he had to worry about. Now, if I would select a different tactic, and even though I know he's going to defend this shot, if I were to really try to put that hook down his throat, well, I could have opened him up that much easier. What I'm trying to tell these outlaws is, though, you're ultimately going to try to pretend to do something. You better get that opponent to be so worried about it, to put so much focus into defending against it, that they have to commit big time in order to accomplish that.
You have to sell it.
You have to sell it. You got to use some of your acting bravado, some of your thespian skills.
Which brings me to my next question. Right now you have someone you're working with, another fighter. But what if you're at home? What if you're in the gym and nobody's there? Can you still work on your feints in front of a mirror?
Well, you could definitely...
On a bag?
Imagine...
Okay.
Scenarios, but no, I don't. You need an opponent. You need a stimulus to respond to see what they respond to and what they don't respond to. And as you get more and more proficient at feinting, you actually select the least amount possible on your end. So look, I could throw a real hook at David, boom. Or I can kind of show him a fainted hook and try to expose him, right? But what if I notice that he's responding to this? Here comes the hoo-ah, 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 boom. Maybe he's responding to my noises instead of the hook. Maybe all I gotta do is slam on the ground, blow mean out of my nostrils. Some guys, you can even look somewhere with your eyes and then punch in a different location. Anything that you notice your opponent is studying on you, you wanna make a note of that in your head, and then you wanna use it against them in the ring.
Coach, in basketball, they say look at the chest. Because if you look at the hands, the legs, the eyes, the head, in boxing, it's the same way. If you and David are working, or fighting, what do you look at when you're fighting? Is it the chest, the shoulder?
A question I constantly get asked, and what I say is, you don't focus on any one thing. You're constantly, 100% of the time, evaluating every situation, every place, every part of his body, every punch he can do, every movement of his body, where you are in the ring simultaneously. What are all the possible scenarios this guy could put me in? Where am I in this ring? How can I respond to that? And maybe it seems unbelievable, Coach, you're full of it. How could you possibly be so aware of all that stuff at once? But hey, anyone who's got a driver's license does this every time they get on the freeway. Think about it, you're constantly scanning the road, this car,
looking
the next
behind,
car, the lanes to the side of you, rear view mirror, your
hey,
speed,
some
your
kids
how many
today
you have,
texting,
driving with
shouldn't
the
be doing that.
And you're thinking of scenarios that
putting on makeup, but a few girls do that
yeah,
when I go to work.
Yeah, some guy speeding in this lane, but going this too slow this way, and you want to change lanes. So constantly you're putting your brain through this same task in a situation, in my opinion, much more dangerous than boxing.
Hey.
If worst comes to worst, he's gonna hit me. But if worst comes to worst on that freeway, I could be in a deadly accident.
You know where I see the crazy shit? When I'm driving on Sepulveda towards Ventura, where it's bumper to bumper in the morning, and you look at me like it's just.
Don't get me going on LA traffic. Let's just stick to
okay.
Feinting here.
So my last question here: you're working on feinting. How do you improve it? Just by practice, or just by? Is there a way to improve feinting, Coach? You're in front of David right now.
Practicing.
Okay.
Yeah. Seeing how your opponent reacts when you do something, which will just take a lot of trial and error in the ring. But here's something that people don't think of a lot. So much psychology, so much reading of your opponent is involved in boxing. Life experiences enhance you. So that's what I would say too, is somebody who's good at more of this tricky stuff is probably a well-rounded person just in life also, because they understand how other human beings react or hide their reactions or try to mask things. So your overall life experiences in a weird way, I think, are going to directly play a role in some of these trickier things of boxing.
And here's the complicated thing about it. Your feinting changes from fight to fight, from opponent to opponent, because what works on him will not work on somebody else.
Oh, and that's the beauty and the misery of boxing. And what he reads on me, he cannot necessarily read on another opponent. So, yeah, every situation is different. Every situation is unique. Every situation, that's the only time you'll ever see it, man. And that's a beautiful thing.
There you go. Last thing, if people want to study feinting, who would you recommend them to watch? What fighters do the best job feinting?
There's a number of the top fighters use feints very well. Floyd Mayweather, you want to see how he got, how he ended up stopping Diego Corrales? Well, he kept feigning that jab, coming with the hook, so you can go and watch that one. Manny Pacquiao is excellent at feigning too. A lot of the movements he does comes via feinting, all right? And when you get your opponent to commit to the wrong thing, and then you hit him with a shot they weren't expecting, that's how you can really hurt a guy, you know? And constantly, Ellie, you're asking me, does so-and-so hit harder than Manny Pacquiao? And I always tell you, well, it's not about that PSI of this guy's punches, because Manny Pacquiao, being an intelligent fighter, knew how to get his opponent to think the wrong thing was going to happen, and a lot of times they just weren't prepared for that shot.
There you have it, Brandon Krause. Thanks, David. For EsNewsReport.com, I'm Melissa, back reporting. You.